same here. Okay.
Let's see. What's up, guys? We have anyone on board yet? If you guys are just tuning in, we're live at Teague Custom Marine. Teague Talk with the Swoops, and we're going to have Bob Teague talk about aerators and propellers and get all the down low on it all. Here's the crew at Teague.
Hope everyone's having a good Wednesday. In the Teague showroom right now, Wednesday, California.
A little behind the scenes.
Okay. Thank you.
Have a good night. See you guys. Hi. Hi, everyone. Thanks for joining us. We're going to get started with our presentation shortly. We're going to do another segment this evening of Teague Talk with the Swoops. We have Summer and Travis Richardson joining us with Bob Teague, and we're going to mostly be going over propeller aerators. A topic you may know a lot about, or you might see them or kind of know what an aerator is, but need really the info. Why do you use an aerator? Would it be good for you to use one? We make all the parts here in-house. We're gonna have some number six drives on stands to actually demonstrate the parts installed, and also some other pieces to show you standalone. So we're gonna be starting shortly here with Bob and Summer. Thanks so much for joining us. We're trying to come up with different topics all the time. So if you guys do like these series, the Teague Talk with the Swoops, we always love your suggestions. You could send me a note on the Facebook page or email me, Sherilyn@teaguecustommarine.com. Love your suggestions. We're trying to do about two a month. So there's a certain topic you want to know more about, technical, or just a certain item. We'll probably do another general propeller video soon. We got a lot of good feedback on that. If you have a setup question. But anyway, keep that in mind. We love your suggestions if you have an idea for a video topic. So I'm gonna flip this around. Hopefully, there we go. Okay. So these are the actual number six drives that are going to be going on Bob's DCB31.
Voice behind the phone. Say hi, Sherilyn.
Hi. Also on our hold tape, you might know my voice. yeah, so these are the number six drives that are actually going to be going on the TCM31, which is pretty cool because you can see the aerators in action here. Hey, we're getting some prep going on here.
He is going.
We have a lot of parts up. Hey guys, we're gonna be starting shortly.
We're gonna talk about aerators.
Yes.
Those tube things.
Yeah.
Those things that are sticking up.
Yeah. What are those?
That everybody says, what is that?
Yeah. Exactly.
Does that blow water in there? No.
Like your Sea-Doo, a little spray out the back.
Yeah. And you got a noodle connected.
Vegas in the house. Yep. Okay, so we're just waiting for a few more people to hop on. We're here at our Valencia, California showroom. A little fun action. Okay, I hear your question, Grant. You want to see the 31? Maybe I'll give you a little sneak peek after the end of the video, pending I have service in the building next door. Try to hook it up over there. Okay, we're here in our showroom. Hi, Mark. Good evening. Thanks for joining us. This is our showroom here in Valencia, California. So anyone can actually come in the store and buy parts here. I don't know if you guys know that. We take orders over the phone, online, or you can just walk in the store. But I think we're about ready to get going. Let's start our conversation here, tonight's episode of Teague Talk with the Swoops. Let's see, Travis, the other cameraman. Do we want to both come on the same side? What side do we want to start on? You guys about ready to start?
We're ready. I mean,
photo
you guys are having all this fun, and we're just standing here like chilling.
Sometimes the camera people need a little
action. A little love too.
We need some love too. Tech.
Do the reverse screen. Give it your
love and everything. Tech committee. Yeah,
what's up, guys?
Tech.
Travis and Sherilyn. What's up, guys?
Okay.
We're the ones that our arms get sore holding the phone.
Yeah, I do usually have some. Well, I have some questions for later in case we don't get some live action. Yeah.
So welcome again to Teague Talk with the Swoops, and we're here at Teague Custom Marine with Bob Teague and Mrs. Swoop.
Mrs. Swoop.
Mrs.
I realize she's hard to look at.
Okay. And today we're talking about prop aerators.
We're not riding horses.
No, not riding horses.
No horses today. Okay.
And a lot of the questions that we get when we're at events, right, is what are these tube things on the back of your drives?
Honestly,
yes.
I've had my race boat on display on several street parties and stuff like that, and actually in pits. And I've had my big skater and my DCBs and everything. And almost the number one question I get.
We get the same thing
is
all the time.
What are those hoses for sticking up off the drives? Do they shoot water in the air or what do they do?
And I go, they don't.
Oh, no. Okay, so what we're talking about tonight is surface drives. Mm-hmm. And surface drives run with the propeller actually above the bottom surface. And so really only half of the propeller is running in the water when the boat's on plane. But that time when the boat's not on plane, the entire drive is buried.
Right.
And so because boats don't have transmissions for the most part, I mean multi-speed.
Right.
And the boat, you know, needs to get the prop moving because you're starting out on high gear. Like if you were starting your car, if you had a manual shift, put it over in high gear and try to drive away, it wouldn't work out so good. Yep. Okay, so the whole idea is of an aerator, number one, and the first idea of it was to let the prop aerate it and actually slip until the boat comes over on plane. And once the boat gets over on plane, then the prop, the aerator is no longer in effect and the prop is in its normal mode servicing. Okay, you can actually feel it shifting gears. It actually comes over on plane and then it locks up and goes into second gear. But as time has gone on, and I'm going to tell you how this started. We developed a propeller or an aerator for number four and number five drives. And this started out, we were running turbocharged motors in an offshore race boat, a 40-foot Fountain. And we took it to a race in Lake Tahoe. And the turbocharged motors would not develop enough speed to put the boat on plane because they wouldn't get freed up. So we developed the aerator actually for a number five drive, and which would actually aerate the propellers, get the boats on plane. If you go back a little further, we had boats like endurance tunnel boats that were in the same situation. We used like a scuba bottle and tubes that went down to the drive, and we turned the bottle on to get the propeller spinning to get the boat on plane.
Wow. Oh, how fun.
So that's way back. That's when we're running number two speed masters. And back in the day when we're running endurance tunnels. And so it kind of evolved to that. So we developed the aerator for a number five drive, and we have one outside, we'll show you, but this is what it looked like. This one on a number five drive, these two bolts come from the underneath side where the drive, the upper and lower, connect together, and then we drill all the way through, put nuts on here. This goes on the cavitation plate, and because the number five or six or four drive is shorter, the prop hang up, the propeller blade would come by here and suck air down this tube and aerate it.
Right.
And this is the first design of an aerator built by Teague Custom Marine.
Bob, what year was that, you think?
This was in 1993. We designed this right here.
So the tube things have been around for some time now.
Yeah, so this is the number five or four or five drive aerator, which we developed back in 1993 to be able to run turbocharged motors at Lake Tahoe. That's how it all designed, because there's no air up there. The engines wouldn't spool up. And a turbocharged motor doesn't have bottom end horsepower until the turbocharger gets spooled up. Yep. And so even today, with the 1350s, 1100s, and any of the turbocharged motors, they really need to have the propeller spool up till the turbos can get up to speed, and then bring boost in, and then you don't need aerators anymore once the boat's on plane. So that's how it started, right there. As time went on, and the number six drives, or was originally a Kiefer drive, came into play, and now, of course, later on, the M8 drives, we started developing products for all those drives. And what we did find out, though, in offshore racing, is that even though the aerators help the boat get on plane and get it going faster, quicker for a start of a race, when you're running in really rough water, and your race boat lands into off of a wave into water and it sinks the drives, the aerator actually frees the engines up quicker so you can get acceleration quicker. And so not only are they an advantage from the standpoint of getting the boat on plane, but they're an advantage of recovering from burying the tail of the boat in a big wave and getting going quicker. So, you know, that was something that was like, oh, this works good. and so most of the race boats today could get on plane without aerators, but in rough water, the advantage of having aerators is the recovery. And of course, if you could save a second accelerating.
Oh yeah, that's everything.
Yeah, it's everything. Because when the boats all both crash off the water, you see the one accelerate and this one doesn't. This one might have aerators, and the other one doesn't.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so as it evolved, we developed aerators for the number six drives, now called an M6, and the M8s, which is the next generation. We build two different aerators for the M8s, and then we also build one for the Indy drives. So we've had all those. So if you look at this. And I'll show you how it works in a minute, but this is 4 and 5, okay? This is an Indy. This goes on the bottom plate of an Indy drive, and then the tube is cut, and I'll show you how it's cut to replicate the propeller. This comes up. So the question is always, what is this? Stick it up. And you've seen the rubber hose, which is actually the best thing. You've seen the rubber hose, but you've also seen people make carbon fiber hose, stainless steel, whatever, you know. Mm-hmm. But when you're dealing with a surface propeller, there's a lot of harmonics. And the harmonics can cause failure to anything that's solid.
Okay.
So the rubber hose is actually the most forgiving.
Hmm.
So,
and it absorbs it.
So this is the deal. When you see a boat, but these things sticking up in the air, that means it's fast. Okay,
it's like
that's
a race.
That means it's fast. So race the guy is not messing around.
Uh-huh.
But the clue is, the key is to, when the thing's idling, to have this thing actually above the water level, because it not only do the aerators help with getting the boat on plane, they help manageability around the docks. So propellers are obviously a lot more efficient going forward than backward because of the way they're cupped and everything like that. So if you have your tube just slightly above the water, when you put the boat in forward gear, it actually aerates the propeller and makes the shifting more gradual, softer, and everything else, and it doesn't make it so abrupt. Of course, propellers are not as efficient going backwards.
Right.
Now you'll see guys with aerators put them in reverse to see water come out of here. Okay, so first thing I'm going to tell you, this is not meant to shoot water in the air, okay? This is meant to suck air down to the propeller, okay? And if you have these on your boat, and if you ever wanted to try this, and you're riding along, if you're crazy enough to do it, if you're riding along, you come back here and put your hand on this thing, you're going to have a hard time getting it off.
Big time suction.
Because it has a lot of suctions.
We don't recommend that, though.
Yeah, we don't recommend that.
We don't want you to go out there.
Don't fall off the side.
These parts right here are made for the Indy drives. This is the upper tube, which goes to the hose that goes up. This is the lower tube, which is a raw tube, which has not been trimmed yet. And I'll show you how that's done.
Okay.
Okay, one of the more popular ones is a six drive. This is the anode that goes on the underside of a six drive. This is a six drive right here. Okay, the anode is what's bolted in on a six drive. And it's held in place with two studs, two nuts, whatever. We make this piece that replaces the anode. Okay, and it has two nuts and a washers that hold it in place, and it goes on the underside of the drive. Okay, this cavitation plate is hollow. So it becomes a complete, up to here, it's totally hollow. So whatever you put here is connected to this. The underneath side, where the pickup is, goes there, and then you have to drill a 3-inch hole in here, and we have this plate that goes in here with the gasket that seals it. Once this is out, you can reach in here and get to the nuts, and then you put the tube on here, and that way this is connected to that. Okay, now they all work the same, and this is a, when the propeller passes in front of this tube, and I've got two different links here. When the propeller passes in front of this tube, it pulls air down through this tube and aerates the prop when the top end of the blade passes across. And if you notice, this one right here is a little further away, about a half to a 5/8 of an inch. This one here is slightly closer, and you can adjust the effectiveness of the aerator based on how close this tube is to the front edge of the blade passing in front of the tube.
Wow.
So if you need more aerator effect, up to about a quarter of an inch is about as close as we get them, because propeller blades do flex. Quarter of an inch will give you maximum effect. If it slips too much coming on plane, you trim the tube a little bit back, and you can adjust it that way. And when you trim this tube, what you do is when you pass a blade in front of it, you trim the tube on somewhat of a radius so that the radius of the front edge of the blade passes in front of it.
Nice, okay.
Okay? Mm-hmm. Air sucked down here into the blade. Remember, this prop shaft is traditionally an average of about 3 inches above the running surface at the bottom. So when the boat is running at speed, the water line's right here, only the half. Once the boat is up on plane and running, this is no longer in effect. Unless the boat comes off a wave, crashes down, and the drive gets buried,
sucks
air into it, frees up the engine. And you know what? It's almost like a cushion to the entire drivetrain, because it takes the load off of it under that torque load, takes the cushion off of it.
Yeah.
Now, Bobby, so, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Go ahead.
I was going to ask you, is there specific like props that kind of change the performance of these, or does that not matter at all? It just depends on the clearance.
No, well, okay, so.
I know I'm getting to it like a.
Okay, you got two things. You prop your boat according to gear ratio, speed, power, right. Everything else. Okay, the aerator is like an accessory.
Okay,
an aerator gets the boat on, you know, lets the boat free up to get on plane, helps the boat recover quickly if you run in rough water, and it buries the drives. So it's an accessory. It does not affect how you would prop the boat, gear ratio or propeller,
okay,
or whatever. Now, of course.
Or type of prop you are using.
Right.
Okay.
You know, there, you know, of course, we go into propeller design and rake and pitch and diameter and everything else. Obviously, if you have more rake, the blade is raked further away from this.
Mm-hmm.
And if you have less rake, the blade is closer. So, for example, if you happen to have a set of propellers on, they're an 18-degree rake, and then you decided to try some 15-degree rake props, you better make sure
that
they clear the aerator, because they're going to be closer to the aerators, and so you want to make sure that clears. But generally speaking, the most efficient aerator is about a quarter of an inch away, and it's radius to the leading edge of the prop. And if you want to get so that it's not so efficient, and but it still does the job, maybe half. Once it gets to a 5/8 to 3/4 of an inch away, it's starting to lose the effect. Okay, so this is the number 6, which is the next generation after the 4, 5, and whatever. At one time, Mercury had a deal where they had a little triangular deal in here with a couple fittings that were tapped into the side of here and had a couple hoses up here, but it needs to be a lot more effective than that. So a 3-inch hose going down to here and a full aerator. This is probably the most popular number 6 aerator.
Setup you see,
right.
Yeah.
And if you look at any of the Super Cats running, if you look at any of the super high performance boats, they have this aerator on them built by Teague Custom Marine. And it's simple because it's already built, and they go, yeah, we need those.
Yep.
So it looks like this when they get it in the kit. It's cut square, it's longer than it needs to be. This has to be trimmed. This is the bottom piece. This is the typical top piece. Like this, it bolts right here, and the hose goes on. Now, we have two different angles because on some boats, this tie bar is further out. The idea is to have this thing come closer to the tie bar, and so we have two different angles that brings us closer to the tie bar. Sometimes the guys tie wrap it to it or whatever. So that's the number 6. Of course, it comes with installation instructions.
Nice.
Okay. And so, and then the other drive is kind of like not available anymore, but people still use. Is the NXT. The NXT was originally designed to run a Maximus propeller, which has got a hub and everything else, so the housing's a lot fatter. But then they evolved to putting number 6 propellers on them. And so the problem is that, once again, it's aerated. An NXT and an M8 has a vent right in here. And it comes from under here. And so the problem is, on a lot of applications, that vent is still underwater, which gives you no benefit when the boat's on idle. So for the NXTs, this is the top piece for an NXT because it has to come up closer to here to work. So it has this flat piece cut off on it like that. And that would be the top piece for the hose. If they choose to just put the lower piece on and have it vent from up here, sometimes this is ineffective because that section is underwater. Mm-hmm. So what we build for the NXTs and the M8s is this plate. This plate inserts into the M8s and the NXTs, and it blocks off the factory vent that sits right in here so that you can get the hose in to get it higher to get air down in there. So this basically goes in here, you drill and tap 2 1/4-20 holes, you set it down there with silicone, and that blocks out that hole and converts it to this hole.
Wow, that's aftermarket.
Aftermarket stuff.
So then you go to the M8s. We have two designs for the M8s. The original M8 design is this one, which is an aerator that replaces the anode that's in the drive, because there's actually an anode down there. It's electronically controlled. It's hooked up to the system and everything else. For the race application, this one is slightly more effective. However, on the pleasure boat on the applications, the people want to have all of those anodes and all that stuff hooked up. And we have developed an enhanced version of the one that is more common on the M8 drives. Now, if you notice, there's a slight radius to this plate. Because if there's on the underneath side of an M8 drive, there's a slight radius in the underneath of the housing. So we actually match this radius to the underneath side. It goes right in front of a little ledge and comes down to the propeller. and then it comes with this gasket. It seals it on the bottom, and then it's tapped and bolted into place on the underneath side. And then, once again, you go back to having the hose. And we also now make this in a heavy duty version. You can see this is quarter inch stainless, heavy wall tube, welded inside, thick, as we call this, a thick wall, number 6M8. Outside, welded inside, because as time's gone on with the drives getting higher and higher and higher, and typically speaking, the M8s have to run higher than the 6s. What that creates is more harmonics from prop vibration. And what it does is it ends up cracking the stock piece that's not as heavy as this. As you can see, this is welded on the inside and outside, the one that goes underneath. This is welded on the inside and outside, quarter thick stainless plate, and then the tube goes up. So the ideal thing for a turbocharged number 8 would be have this on the underside, which would be like a 1350. This gasket seals it. This goes on the top side. You seal it, you seal the stock M8 vent, which is too far underwater, with this, which directs the airflow to come down through the hose to this tube.
Right.
And that way you have the most effective aerator. Now the thing is about turbocharged motors is they don't start making power till the turbo spool up. Mm-hmm. If you can't get the propeller spooling up, turbocharger can't spool up. And so that is why we developed this program with the block off, with the aerator, with the tube that goes on an MA drive. And so far it's been very successful. Okay, so in review. Number 5.
Review for you, do it yourself first.
Indy. Indy drive.
And you'll get your worksheet to go with it.
These are the two different tops for the number 6, number 8, NXT top. Number 6 bottom.
Whoa.
And the original number 8, M8 bottom, which replaces the anode. People want to keep the anode. This is the one that goes on the bottom. Block off that stock vent, and you're good.
Okay, so we have some questions coming in. That was really good. So we have all kind of people watching right now. We have a lot of end users watching, so just boaters, people that might want to work on their own boat. We also have some manufacturers watching. DCB's watching and said hello, and thank you, DCB. They do buy a lot of these kind of components from us.
They use this.
Yes. So kind of to tie that in, knowing that a lot of DCBs, even if they don't have Teague power, they do use a lot of these type of components that we make here. And someone asked, well, you know, what you just said about the turbos, but a 1350 is almost instant boost. So why would these boats with like some of those bigger turbo engines maybe still want the aerator? Like DCB does use them.
They use them because there's that time where you put the throttle and the motor's trying to
catch up.
Mm-hmm. And the quicker that the propeller starts spinning faster, and once you get the RPM up in the motors, then you start getting the turbo spinning up, which creates a boost. The aerators mm-hmm. will help a turbo motor get on plane faster. And I'm pretty sure that most of the turbocharged DCBs, while you're talking about that, are running aerators.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
We gathered a lot of those tube pictures for
right,
this
yeah.
post.
We can show you the pictures, yeah.
This year we learned that firsthand with the Dial 911 skater. Mm-hmm. You know, it was a supercharged boat, and then we converted it to turbo motors and basically had to call T mm-hmm. Custom Marine and get some aerators for it because
well,
it was...
Well, yeah, Don let it call yep. whips, and this thing takes forever to get rolling. That's her dad, by the way.
My dad.
Yeah, she is actually originally a London. Okay, I got in trouble for saying that once. But anyway, it just helps get the things rolling. And remember, the original reason that we developed an aerator, and this is way before... Mercury started developing the, you know, 1100s, 1350s and all that stuff, was that we were running Gentry turbo motors or race aero turbo motors in a 40-foot fountain race boat. And then we had a race at Tahoe. The boat would not go on plane.
Oh.
It would not go on plane. They just sat there and go, nothing happened.
Right.
And so that's where we came, it had number five drives on it. That's where we came up with this. This goes on a number five drive. That saved the day. And
these things have
we're
come
probably
a long
the
way.
Only ones ever that built an aerator for a number four or five drive. Because remember, the propellers actually hung out on a four or five drive beyond the upper case. You know, because the way they built them. So that's where it started. And then it just evolved from there. But with the race boats, with, let's say, a high compression Super Cat or whatever, and this goes back to when we were running Pontiac heads and all the stuff and modified boats, the boats had a hard time getting to a point where they made enough power to get on plane. Well, when you come out of a milling circle and the green flag, you know, and the yellow flag's up and you gotta get going, and you're sitting there, you know, and the thing won't start moving, that's pretty scary. And so the aerators get them moving. The later thing, when we were racing in Pacific offshore, and we were racing in, you know, like waves were as big as mountains and houses and all this other stuff, we discovered that the boat recovers a lot faster with aerators. And so as time goes on, I have actually never raced a boat since then
without
aerators. Because when you both land at the same time, and the guy with the aerators goes like that, that's all you need. And because the motors get freed up, but it's just almost like slipping a clutch a little bit. It gives you, it's a little harder on the valve, it's a little easier on the valve train, on the drivetrain and everything else, because it unloads it right away until the boat gets back into speed zone. And so it's amazing what they do. But once again, it's a surface drive animal.
So
it's designed for a boat that has surface drives, whether it be NXTs, 5.6s, or M8s, where the propeller is designed to run above the bottom of the boat.
Okay, that's perfect, because that really leads into a few people are asking a very similar question, because you're talking about the applications it works on. Would this work for a Bravo drive application? And if not, you know, is this something that depends on the X dimension? And then someone else said, do you ever run it on a Bravo application? Like if you're running a 5 or 6 blade prop, can you put a larger shaft in to run a number 6 prop? But it's like, does it work with a Bravo ever?
Well, we haven't developed anything that works with a Bravo because the way a Bravo drive works and Bravo XR or whatever, is that a certain depth of propeller creates a certain amount of lift to the boat. And even though a lot of people are running close to surfacing the drives, the propellers aren't big enough to put that much load. Mm-hmm. And remember what I said was, one of the things that helps with an aerator is managing your boat around the docks. When you put the boat in forward gear, especially when you're running 40 pitch props and a 129 gear and everything else, you put it in forward and all of a sudden the thing wants to go 8 miles an hour forward. And so, but if you have aerators and you have the drives trimmed to the point to where the tubes are out of the water, it makes the boat a lot more manageable. Remember, the props are not that efficient going backward, but they are efficient going forward. And so that helps. With the Bravo drives, and one of the things that we are looking at is maybe developing, because we've developed other parts for them, but maybe developing an aerator for like a SCX4. Which is the IMCO drive, which is really designed to surface, but it's going to be a little bit of a challenge because every style of prop is a little bit different. But an SCX4 does run a number 6 propeller like this, and so you might be able to gain some advantage. But so far, it's primarily geared toward at this point NXTs, 6s, and M8s.
Great.
Hey, Bob, while we have the drive out, question we get a lot is, at speed, 140, 150 miles an hour, how much of the propeller is in the water?
Less than half.
Less than half.
Which you were showing
less than half, right. Mm-hmm. Because remember, if the running surface is, let's say, 3 inches below the prop shaft center line, the whole idea, let's say a good running catamaran, if you look down the surface of the boat and the drives are trimmed at neutral,
right,
you should be looked down from the bow, look down the running surface of the boat and see skeg and no gear case. If you see gear case, that means the gear case is gonna surf the water and it's gonna start lifting the tail. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people get confused. They say, you know, I'm kind of losing my steering at top speed, and they think they need to lower their drives to regain their steering, and they're actually going the wrong way, because what's happening is the gear case is surfing and lifting the tail. If you raise the drive a little bit, so all's just being seen by the clean water coming off the bottom of the boat is skeg, it'll settle the boat back down.
Good.
Yep, got it.
And then we have another prop question. We kind of answered this earlier, but they want to know if you are using aerators, maybe you add them or whatnot, does that actually allow you to use a higher pitch of a prop? And if so, how many degrees?
Okay, so degrees is rake.
Okay,
so typically, the rakes vary. There are some that are 12 degrees, but the typical rakes are between 15, 18, and 20, or 21. In other words, and the rake is how far the blade is swept back.
Okay,
the further the blade is swept back, and we're talking about, forget about aerators, just the further the rake is swept back, the more lift the propeller provides. Okay, so does it lift the tail, or does it lift the stern, or does it lift the bow? That is depending on which way the propellers are rotating.
In or out, right?
Right, in or out. Mm-hmm. So if propellers are rotating out, which is right, right, left, left, or if the propellers are rotating in, right, left, yeah, left, right, okay? You gotta remember that even in a catamaran, you have sponsons that are on an angle. In a V-bottom, you have a V that's on an angle. The water that's coming off the back of the boat is clean off the bottom of the boat. So if the propellers are spinning out and they're going like this, more the down sweep of the blade sees clean water than the up sweep. What that does is it creates tail lift, mm-hmm, bow, transom lift, whatever you want to call it. If the propellers are turning in, more of the upsweep is seeing clean water, which pulls the tail down, which creates bow lift. Now, there are some variables, because on catamaran, sometimes you get the drive closer where it's seeing water coming through the tunnel.
Mm-hmm.
So it kind of balances it a little bit. But that's generally the rule, that turning out lifts the tail, turning it in lifts the bow. Okay, that's generally the rule. So if you have, for example, our 44 skater, originally built it with the props turning out, 18 degree props, and the boat was fine except for, you know, when you're going along and, you know, it's cruising at 120, turn the boat, you can feel the sponson dig a little bit. Took those same props, switched the drive, turn them in. Now you can't even see over the bow where you're driving it because it's lifting the nose so high. Switch it to 15 degree props, it set it back down, made it more drivable for a pleasure boat. Okay, so turning out, it's gonna lift the tail. Now, generally speaking, on a lot of the faster catamarans, turning out is the fastest setup. But it's also
the scarier setup.
Yeah,
it's
also very light on the water.
You don't feel like you're connected.
So turning in, you know, and the other thing that you have to consider is sometimes boats are turning out, have a tendency to porpoise in that kind of sort of a min range area, 70 to 90, whatever. And mm-hmm, sometimes turning in, that cures that. But, you know, what we're not dealing with here is race boats. Right. What we're dealing here with pleasure boats.
Yeah.
We're dealing with something that's comfortable to drive at all speeds. You want to build, you don't want to say, I can't drive this boat at 80 because at 80 it's uncomfortable. Yeah.
It's porpoising.
You know, yeah, it's porpoising, whatever. So. Yeah. That's one of the things you have to do. So prop height, you know, and and degrees of rake, and whether they're turning in or out affect all that. Now there's another thing, tow in and tow out. You gotta remember, when a propeller is turning out, it wants to separate the drives like this, because there is a little bit of play in the gimbal and everything else. And so if it's turning out, the major part of the load on the propeller is this way, which pulls, wants to load the gimbals this way. So if your propellers are turning out, it actually wants to make the tow in more in, like that. If your propellers are turning in, it wants to pull them out.
Yeah.
Okay, so normally speaking, if you're turning your propellers in, if you tow the drives in an eighth of an inch, and that is the difference between the point of the drives and the center of the prop shafts, if it's towed in, it will pull them more neutral as the propeller is turning in. And
but
and
the tow is between each drive, correct?
Well, the tow in is like an automobile. All automobiles have tow in, which makes them not shimmy going down the road.
Right.
Okay, so what you don't want is the drives hunting around. So they got to have a slight amount of load on. So if the drives are towed in slightly, in other words, the points of the drives closer together than the end of the prop shafts, okay, and then your propellers are turning in, it's going to want to pull the back of the drives closer together. It's going to put a trailer.
Yep.
And it's opposite if you're turning them out. But another factor, water coming off the sponsons and water coming off the V bottom is not actually 100% straight back. It's being separated by the V or the sponsons, so it's actually not 100% on a straight angle. So 99% of the time, toe in is better than toe out, because it's pointing at the water that's coming out.
Make sense? So getting back to the original question.
What was the question?
Yeah, the degree.
Sorry in advance, everybody.
The
yeah, the, I think it was the pitch of the prop.
And the, yeah.
Yes.
Okay. But
Grant
remember,
was
the pitch
asking,
doesn't rake. Matter yes. with the aerator.
Well, they were confusing
rake, okay,
pitch and degree.
Thing. Rake,
but
the lower the rake, the less the lift. The higher the rake, the more the lift. Okay? Okay, if your ears are pointy, like a cleaver, it has a tendency to lift the tail. If you have a round ear propeller, and some people call it a chopper, it has a tendency to create nose lift. And that and that's just kind of basics. And then everything else is like, you got to try it.
Yeah.
Okay.
You just got to call it T-Custom Marine.
Yeah.
I mean, we're just getting a lot more questions. Not sure if this is relevant. Sorry for everyone. I just flipped that on my own face by accident. they want to know, okay, what about, getting lots of questions here. What about Blackhawks and what about extension boxes? Does that affect your whole deal?
Okay,
Blackhawk is history, unfortunately. And it was probably the first attempt by Gary Meisenberg at Mercury Racing to create a racing drive with a counter-rotating propeller. They actually developed some other improvements with Bravo gears based off of that drive, because the drive was so positive when it shifted, it would blow the gears up, so they had to come up with some other things which evolved into better gears in the drives. However, the Blackhawk was basically a racing version of a Bravo 3.
Okay.
It was a servicing Bravo 3.
Nice.
No longer available. I don't even know if there's hardly any parts for them. And if you have one, you know, it is awesome.
Call Teague.
The truth is that Craig Archer, Nigel Hook, and I did a 26 gear of A-bug, and we actually set a kilo record in it with a Blackhawk on it.
Oh wow!
But we would probably never race it with the Blackhawk because it was you put it in gear and all of a sudden you're going like 20 miles an hour at idle. And so, but anyway, that's a Blackhawk. And what was the other part of that?
Someone else asked, how about extension boxes? How does that affect our deal here?
This is a very, very vague rule of thumb. If you put an extension box on, let's say a foot, you know, whether it be a, you know, an old Stellings or an Imco or a Latham, whatever, a foot back, a rule of thumb. For every foot back you go, the drive needs to be an inch higher.
Okay.
Because because the theory is, as the water comes off the bottom of the boat, it starts rising. You know, like you're digging a hole in the water when you're going along, and the water starts rising. The advantage of an extension box is that you can run a higher drive height and still get the boat on plane, and once the boat's going fast, have less wetted surface on the gear case. Okay, that's basic. However, some boats are out of balance. Some boats are balanced well without an extension box. When you move the drive back, sometimes it changes the balance. And remember, it's the point where the propeller is on an apex to where the trailing edge of the running surface is, and a balance of the weight in the boat. If you get the weight too far back, then it might make the thing too nose light. And so the idea with the extension boxes work on boats that need them, but don't automatically assume that your boat's going to be better with an extension box if it's good now.
Yeah.
Good. You don't always need to fix it if it ain't broke.
Every other problems.
Sometimes don't fix it if it ain't broke.
Yeah. There you go.
Right.
We got some good analogies here. Jason, this is hilarious. This is like standing under a waterfall of knowledge with a solo cup. I'm digging it though. Just catch what you can, man.
Yeah. Okay. Right. This started out as aerators.
Yeah, we went a little off tangent.
We have like a whole other segment just on drives and the tie bars and everything.
Right.
Yeah.
It could keep going here.
Or just open discussion.
Yeah, discussion.
Q&A. How about we just have one where we just say, okay, what do you want to know?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Or submit, you know, through Swoop or the Teague page. We can always take video suggestions. We'll always take suggestions of what kind of topics you guys want to see, too. Mm-hmm.
I get 20 emails a day where I can actually turn into a magazine column.
A little segment, yeah.
Yeah, right.
So, I mean, that covered most of the questions on this. We'll probably do another one soon where we should just do general setup or like propeller topics again.
Anything they want.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Open.
Hey, you
open
know what? Questions. This is the deal. If I don't know, I'll find out.
Yep.
Right.
That's true.
But I probably know. Hey, the cool thing is, I get to hang out with Mrs. Swoop.
The cool thing is, I get to hang out with Bob Teague.
Yeah. It is pretty good team.
It's fun.
Okay.
Cool.
Good.
So email or submit any questions or as far as any ideas for another segment and
if you want to send me something, Bob Teague, TeagueCustomMarine.com. Send me questions and we'll bring them up on our next deal, maybe next Wednesday, whenever that's going to be.
Yeah.
And we're trying to do this once a week. We had a little vacation thing, whatever, you know.
Or like
and,
twice a month.
Yeah.
Every year. Yeah, we have things
what,
in the
you
way.
Miss me that much? You guys see me every week?
This is a lot of work to produce these, okay?
I know.
We're staying overtime.
Bob, I know one question everyone's been asking is how close are we to see the Teague M31 edition?
Oh, maybe that could
about
be.
About 2 weeks.
About 2 weeks out, wow.
Maybe we'll do a live on that. Like
we're
going to
do a live thing on that. First motor is going in today. The second motor will probably go in a few days. And everything else is done. We're going to have to lift it and put it over on the trailer that was built by Adrenaline Trailers. Badass.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
Adrenaline makes some great trailers.
Yeah,
check them out.
They're doing
Adrenaline
a great
trailers.
Job. And it's got all the foo-foo lights and all that stuff.
Yes. Bob, what will be the first event you think you'll debut it at?
Well, it's going to be a Big Cat Poker Run.
Big Cat Poker Run, the
Discovery Bay.
August 18th.
And if you're not going to the Big Cat Poker Run, you should. Big Cat Poker Run.
California Delta.
Sign up.
It's the funnest. It's the funnest thing with the most classy people. You have a blast.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We've been there. It was a good time. It was definitely different boating, but it was a lot of fun.
It's a lot of boating, and it benefits the children charities for the Lions Club in Discovery Bay.
Yes.
And that's what we do.
Perfect. Perfect.
And then we'll also tell everyone, reading comments, you can still watch the full videos after.
Yes.
This will be on the Teague Facebook page, just in our video section. and then eventually on our YouTube as well.
And also on Swoop Motorsports Instagram page, we'll have that running for the next 24 hours as well.
The other thing is, I would look a lot prettier if I wasn't standing next to her.
And you can do a blonde wig.
Not bad.
So we can, like,
I can get a blonde wig.
Not bad.
Yeah.
I'm blonde.
There you go.
Bring it to Lotto. Grant, it's not going to be, I don't think it's going to be at Lotto. Bob has to be testing boats with Speedboat and Speed on the Water at Lotto.
That's right.
No fun times.
No fun,
working.
Just work.
No work.
Working.
Just work, and I'll be doing the show.
Yeah, he'll be helping announce.
Enjoy cocktails for us.
Yeah. Cocktails and docktails.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. Okay. So
perfect.
I think if I missed any questions, we'll go back through this tomorrow on our Facebook page, and I'll type answers. And yes, you can watch the videos again, rewatch them on Facebook and YouTube.
Yep.
Thank you so much, everyone, for tuning in.
Thanks, everyone, for tuning in.
Thank you for joining us. We'll see you in 2 weeks.
Probably 2 weeks.
Tea Talk with the Swoops.
Yeah.
Thanks, everybody.
We'll announce our next video soon. Thanks, everyone.